blockbuster trade, sending James Harden to the Brooklyn Nets to team up with Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving. We now welcome former NBA champion Kendrick Perkins to the show.
We got to see if it does.
It's going to be a fun fascination. I mean, KD went from the Splash Brothers to the Dribble Brothers. It's going to be fun watching them play.
Dribble.
Spurs and Rockets coming up from San Antonio. Back with more in a second.
No matter what sport you look at, I ain't seen this kind of offensive firepower. Now I'm wondering who's going to play defense. I'm wondering who's going to toughen Brooklyn up. And certainly they could be had by Milwaukee, by Philadelphia. Yeah, they could be had. I don't think Boston's deep enough. I don't think Miami's got the talent. And I don't think Toronto has the talent anymore either. So it would be about Philadelphia and Milwaukee as being the primary threats to knock them off. But points win games. And when you got that kind of offensive power, particularly with the ability for Kevin Durant to close, to me, it's a trip to the finals or bust. You know, you might have an excuse to lose to the Lakers and whatever, but I don't see any excuse why Brooklyn, if they get their act together, should not come out of the East. There really is no excuse for this.
SA, you just gave the biggest caveat, if they get their act together. If you're Steve Nash, how the hell do you manage all these personalities?
I think he's going to have the help of Kevin Durant. And I honestly don't believe James Harden is going to be a problem. I think James Harden gets a bad rap in this respect. You know what? Yeah, he wants his players. He wanted Dwight, and then he didn't. He wanted CP3, and then he didn't. He wanted Russell Westbrook, and then that didn't work out. He dribbles the damn ball too much. I get all of that. But this dude has averaged at least 30 a game the last 3 years, at least 29 a game the last four, at least 28 a game the last five. This dude is a sensational offensive player, and here's the biggest thing about him. You know this, Jay. He don't believe in load management. This dude don't take nights off. That's not what he did. We were shocked at the way he's played over the last five games because we know better, and we know what he was trying to do, and we're disappointed that he would go that route, particularly throwing his own teammates under the bus, because that's not who we know him to be. But outside of that, you know that James Harden is going to come to play. And now that he's taken the shrapnel of criticism that's been thrown in his direction, I think he's going to be more motivated than ever before. He knows he's on a legitimate title contender, that they're legitimate favorites in some people's eyes because of the talent they assembled. And he knows that if he doesn't win here, it'll look worse than when he didn't win in Houston because he didn't have Kevin Durant as his teammate. The key is Kyrie Irving. And there's some problems going on there. Let's just call it what it is. We don't know what the hell it is, and even if we did know, we wouldn't say if it was something personal because that's none of our damn business. But the bottom line is Kyrie don't seem all there. Literally, figuratively, mentally, spiritually, he's just in another place other than Brooklyn. And I don't know if that's on Steve Nash to resolve. That's on Kevin Durant because this is Kevin Durant's team. You know better than anybody, Jay Williams, that Kyrie Irving wouldn't be in Brooklyn if it were not for Kevin Durant. They brought Kyrie Irving there because Kevin Durant made it clear he wanted Kyrie Irving there with him. That is why Kyrie Irving is there. So now the onus is on KD to handle that situation with Kyrie or to support the Brooklyn Nets if they decide to go in a different direction than Kyrie. Kevin Durant needs to sign off on that, and he needs to also make things happen with or without Kyrie. That's what he's got to do.
Stephen A. Smith, First Take, host of Stephen A.'s World. You can catch it on ESPN+. Stephen A., let me ask you this, though. In terms of the Brooklyn Nets trio, is this trio better than the Splash Brothers with KD?
No. Hell no. Absolutely not.
Talent-wise, Stephen A., talent-wise? Talent-wise, they're not? I'm not saying the way it works out, but talent-wise, sheer talent?
Jay, I'm thinking about two things. Number one, do you know of a better shooting trio, arguably in NBA history, than Klay Thompson, Steph Curry, and Kevin Durant? The answer would be no. And we all know that Klay plays defense, okay? And we all know that it's hard. Who's going to sacrifice? Klay Thompson sacrificed in Golden State. Chris Bosh sacrificed in Miami. Ray Allen sacrificed in Boston. Who's going to be the third wheel, and who's going to accept and embrace that role and make the necessary sacrifices? That's the huge question. I understand you're talking about talent, But I'm just basically getting to the bottom line. Like, for example, nobody has a better handle than Kyrie Irving. And Kyrie Irving can shoot, and he can score on anybody. He can finish at the basket. I think that Steph Curry is the greatest shooter in the history of mankind. Agreed. And I think that Klay Thompson is one of the top five shooters in NBA history. And I think that Kevin Durant is one of the top five scorers in the history of basketball. I don't think it's blasphemous or sacrilegious to sit up there and say, as great as Kyrie is, as great as James Harden is, as great as Kevin Durant is, that they are not more talented than Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, and KD together. I don't believe it.
But see,
because
Stephen
then it comes down to Harden and Kyrie. So is Harden and Kyrie better than the Splash Brothers? I would tell you, as shooters, hell no.
Well, I mean, as gifted players, though, I mean, depending upon what system, here's what I will say. I think James Harden, I say, gets the wrong look here, right? Because he's been on a team where he's had to be the guy with the system he's been provided to drop 35, 40 points every night. So everybody automatically assumes, how's it going to work? He's going to dribble the ball all the time. He will acquiesce. He can be a pass guard that can still score and play off these other two guys.
I agree. I don't disagree with you at all. I mean, I think that you're absolutely 100% right about James Harden. People ignore the fact that he registers assists. Even when he was playing like garbage because he didn't want to be there, he was still averaging 10 assists a game. This dude can do what he wants to do, and he's shown incredible unselfishness in the past. Remember when he was in OKC, he was basically the backup point guard. You're in Houston. I've seen many times when he set up other guys to score. I'm not questioning the talent and the greatness of James Harden. I'm just saying that Steph Curry and Klay Thompson are such marksmen. I think it's the likes of which we've never seen. They're the greatest shooting backcourt in history. And Steph Curry is the greatest shooting backcourt known to man. And there's not a human being that I've ever seen that can shoot better than Steph Curry, ever. Standing still, spot up, jump shot, set shot, corner, wing, key, the other wing, it don't matter. 30 feet, 40 feet, 50 feet, 20 feet, it doesn't matter. This dude is the greatest shooter I have ever seen with my two eyes.
I don't think he's under the most pressure. For me, it would be Kawhi Leonard. And the reason I feel that way, and I haven't jumped off that bandwagon, I've been consistent, and I know I'm standing alone. But Kawhi Leonard is the one that came to Los Angeles with the NBA title from Toronto and the NBA Finals MVP. That was fine. But the dude with the commercials and talking about L.A. is his town now with the king dangling from his the crown dangling from his mirror and all of that stuff, basically putting LeBron on notice. It's a new day, and here I come. And then you have a 3-1 lead to the Denver Nuggets, and you disappear in a game seven. You let him come back from a 3-1 deficit. He wasn't the only one. We know Paul George was, too. I got that. But it's Kawhi Leonard that was that two-time champion. It's Kawhi Leonard that was that star. It was Kawhi Leonard that basically told the Clippers, you want any shot at me, you got to go and mortgage the farm to get me Paul George. Otherwise, I'm going to stay in this town and play for the other team, which is the Los Angeles Lakers, with LeBron and AD, which will ensure you'll never win again. So all of those things that happen, that's Kawhi Leonard. Excuse me, it's time to pay up. You showed up. You put those demands. They answered the bell. Now you got to answer the bell. This dude, by Max Kellerman, was considered the best player in the world. Number one, that's what Max was saying. Max was talking all of that, Kendrick. He said, Kawhi is that dude. He's number one. I know the whoops and the oops ultimately came thereafter, but damn it, that was after a year saying he was the best in the world. And listen, you can say what you want about Harden. He's been on the radar. KD's back. He's on the radar. Kyrie's on the radar. We get all of that. Why does Kawhi Leonard get to fly under the radar? He is a superstar. He is one of the top five players in the world. I want to see him show up. And I desperately, desperately want to see him go against LeBron head up, straight up, in the conference finals. That's my dream scenario, personally.
All right. Before I get to Kendrick Perkins, who tweeted some outrageous, blasphemous nonsense last night. Let me deal with you first, Stephen A. That take would be correct if the Clippers...